Good afternoon, friends. First of all, I am very thankful to you for inviting me to this prestigious meeting, and I am also very grateful that you have been waiting for so long for the whole series of lectures which are going on there. Now, the topic which has been given to me is about Hindu nationalism versus Indian nationalism. Now, this has been coming up as a forefront topic from last many years. Particularly last 3 years, if we see, this issue has become very important. And I'll just recite two incidents before I go to the main topic of what I'm going to present. Now, you all recall that before 2014 elections, our present Prime Minister that time came to Bombay, and he was canvassing for votes for him. And he made a statement that, look, I am born in a Hindu family. I am a nationalist. So I am a Hindu nationalist. Now, this struck something wrong with me. And I felt that this is not the way nationalism is presented. Religion cannot be prefixed to nationalism in the democratic setup. Religion cannot be the prefix in a secular democratic country where pluralism is there, people of all religions are living, and we have a democratic right of citizenship irrespective of our religion. Now, along with this, other topics have also come up. No doubt that last 3 years, if we see close to 3 years, assertion, domination of different organizations related to Hindu nationalist concept have become very important, very forceful, very dominating. And this so-called nationalism, which I think is not a nationalism in a way, which is actually a reactionary nationalism, which I'll explain, got manifested in various events. Two major events stand in front of us. One, I hope you recall, the forced suicide of Rohit Vemula. Rohit Vemula was forced to commit suicide, and that time, if you remember, all the activities of Ambedkar Student Association, to which Rohit Vemula was associated, they conducted various programs related to screening of a film, organizing a beef festival, and talking against the death penalty in a democratic society. Now, instigated by this, as a reaction to this, the local BJP MP said that Hyderabad Central University is becoming the den of anti-national activities. Now, what are the anti-national activities with which Rohit Vemula was involved? Screening of films, discussions, debates, participation in beef festival in this society. This was dubbed anti-national. Second, again, I recall the incident of Jawaharlal Nehru University, and you all must be familiar. I'm sure Kanhaiya Kumar has visited Kerala at least once. So in that case also, the freedom of expression which was going on in Jawaharlal Nehru University, which came in the form of organizing meetings in support of human rights of different type of people. And when these activities were not to the liking of this ruling party, they organized a thing according to which one CD was doctored. It was manipulated, and then some TV channels displayed that CD over and over again. It showed that Kanhaiya Kumar and other students of Jawaharlal Nehru University, they were shouting slogans which sounded to be anti-India. I must clarify here that shouting of slogans is not anti-national. Whenever there is an instigation for violence, that becomes anti-national. Whenever you are expressing your opinion through slogans or through talks, that is not anti-national. So again, Kanhaiya Kumar and his friends, they were arrested, beaten up in police custody, and then court came forward to say that shouting slogans, the way it has come up, it has nothing to do with anti-national activities as such. So these two things lead us to think, what is this new concept of nationalism which is being promoted during last 3 years? Also, I will recall and tell you that just before the elections, as I was talking about our Prime Minister coming to Bombay and making the proclamation that I am born in a Hindu family, I am a nationalist, so I am a nationalist. At the same time, in contravention to the democratic norms, one of his present cabinet colleagues who hails from Bihar, his name is Giriraj Singh. Giriraj Singh said that those people who do not vote for Modi should go to Pakistan. I don't know what is this type of nationalism. Incidentally, in a lighter vein, I can tell you, in those elections, only 31% of people, citizens, voted for Modi. 69% voted against him. So what should we do with those 69% people who did not vote for Modi? That's a million-dollar question for me. Anyway, so what is this nationalism? How does it come up? How did it come up in India? Does it come up in the similar fashion all the places? No. I must say, Indian nationalism, or the very concept of nationalism, comes here during colonial period. Let's be very clear. Before the British came, I'll come pick up this thread of British coming here, introducing certain changes because which led to the rise of two types of nationalism. What were these two types of nationalism? One was Indian nationalism, which came up from the rising classes of businessmen, industrialists, workers, and modern educated classes. At the same time, the declining classes in the form of landlords, princely states, kings, they came up with another articulation, and that was nationalism in the name of religion. Nationalism under the garb of religion. So these people from declining classes, landlord, princes, whom I can turn a very popular Hindustani phrase, Raja, Nawab, Zamindar, Jagirdar, these people came up with nationalism under the garb of religion. So this way came up Muslim nationalism and Hindu nationalism both. So I was talking of how these nationalisms came up. Before that, let's realize that in human society, nationalism is not a divine, eternal word. Human society has constantly been changing, right from the times of when man was hunter, gatherer of food, to the present time. There is a constant change in human organization, in the social organization of human beings, according to the mode of production, according to the way society is producing. So when it is a hunter-gatherer stage, we had the tribes. We had the tribes with a tribal chief. The concept of citizenship, concept of nation was not there. Maximally, it was restricted to the tribe. After that comes the phase in which human society comes in to become the pastoral society, means they are dependent on animals, they rear them, eat their flesh, and they also consume their milk. So this is pastoral society, and this description of pastoral society you will richly find in Vedas, in the early period of Vedas in particular. With this comes the next stage of human society, when man becomes the agriculturist. So first hunter-gatherer, then pastoralist, and then comes this agriculture settled stage. With the settled agricultural state rises on one side religions, different religions. People claim religion to be eternal. I must point out that the birth of religion takes place with the agricultural society. Again, in India, different religious tendencies were there. They came together and lumped under the umbrella of Hinduism. In Hinduism, on one side, there is Brahmanism, on the other side there is Shramanism. What is Brahmanism? Brahmanism means a system which believes in the hierarchy, birth-based hierarchy of caste and gender. So this is Brahmanism. What is Shramanism? Shramanism are those tendencies which developed in our country, which like Nath, Tantra, Bhakti, Siddha, Shaiv, Siddhant, these are the religious tendencies which are not much known today. What do these religious tendencies say? These tendencies are away from Brahminical values because they deny the hierarchy of caste, they deny the hierarchy of gender, they believe in the equality of society. So, like Hinduism comes up, on the other side, if you see globally and also in India, we see the rise of Buddhism, Jainism, later on Islam, Christianity, Sikhism. So these are the religions which come up with the agricultural society. Now this is accompanied by kingdoms. Now in kingdom, on one side there is a king who has a supreme authority. On the other side there is a religious clergy which takes up the mantle of defending the values of kingdom in the language of religion. So whole inequality of kingdoms is presented, made palatable by the system of clergy. This time also there is no nation. This is what I will call that nationalism develops with the concept of citizenship. Believe me, you in kingdoms which many of us tend to glorify, the concept of citizenship is not there. People are like king is regarded as a son of God, clergy, pope, acharya and maulana, they are regarded as a representative of God, and this alliance of king and clergy rules while the society is regarded as the subject. So king is a ruler and people are the subject. So this is again not a nation. What is this? This is kingdom. And believe me you, the very word nation state comes into existence from 17th century in the world. Now in India, of course, it develops a bit later and it develops with the colonial period when the British come. Okay, so now in the European countries, with the development in the post-Renaissance period, where science established itself, where technology came into being, with that the people started challenging the authority of the king. People started challenging the moral dictates of the clergy. And this is what gave to the revolutions in France and various other European countries. And I think the best example is that of France, where under the banner of liberty, equality, fraternity, a democratic, secular revolution takes place, and that lays the foundations of French Republic. Republic, here the people have the primacy. So far, king is primary, subjects are secondary. Now, the subjects become primary. They are the authority, and the rulers become secondary as a sort of a representative body to implement what the people decide. And this is the foundation of nation-state in the modern times. Now in India, what happens? In India, the problem is a bit complicated. Why it is complicated? Because British come here. And why did British come here? British come here, again there are various theories. They themselves claim that we came here to civilize these barbarians. They famously claim that Lord Almighty put a weight on their shoulder that they should civilize these barbarians, and that's what their claim is, that's how they came to the colonies. But primarily, why they came to the colonies? Why they colonized? Because they wanted to plunder the wealth of these countries. So please remember, there is a difference between kingdom and there is a difference between colonial state. So British come. And I must remind, one of your Kerala person has written a brilliant book on empire, The writer of that book is Shashi Tharoor. Shashi Tharoor has written an excellent book on the empire and how it plundered India of thousands and thousands of crore. Okay. So here, as they come to plunder, they bring in certain new changes. What are these three new changes which the British bring in? Number one, they have to take away the wealth from this country. And for that, they developed transport system so that from the interiors of the country, material can be taken to the port cities. Port cities like Kozhikode, Mumbai, Kolkata, Chennai. So, development of the ports, development of the maritime thing, and development of the inner transport in the form of railways. So, I'll make it a bit easier for us to remember. So, with the coming of British, first change which comes up is in the form of railways. Number two, the British Viceroy, that time was a sole person, representative of the British Empire, and for his administrative convenience, he brought in new methods of communication. These new methods of communication, just to make it easy to remember, these were in the form of telephone, telegraph, and the postal system. So the first I say word rail. Here I use the word mail. The third system we developed was that for the modern administration. And for modern administration, they on one hand introduced modern education, and this modern education gave rise to the modern educated classes. So with the modern administration, one part which came up, which was also very important for the British rule, was that of a jail, system of law, system of punishment, as a representative form, I'll put it as a single word called jail. So I hope you can remember this, the three new changes, rail, mail, and jail. Now with this comes in the social changes, and in these social changes, three new social classes come up. In Kerala, where left is so dominating, I don't try to explain what is class. Class means group of people doing similar type of work. So with the British coming in, they introduce industries. The first class which comes up is that of businessmen industrialist. And in this group, there is Tata, Birla, Bajaj, Singhania, Dalmia. They set up industries, and in the industries, a new group of people come up, and that is industrial workers. And the third new group comes up is a form of modern educated classes. So this I represent as the rising classes. What are the rising classes? Rising classes are businessmen industrialists, industrial workers, and modern educated classes, rising classes. On the other side, the old classes, which should have been thrown into the dustbin of history, they survived. In Europe, new classes come up, new ideology comes up, they throw away the old classes of landlords, kings, and all that hierarchy into the dustbin of history along with their ideology. But in India, this is a central problem. What is the problem? New classes come up, old classes continue. And these old classes, they are in the form of Hindu, Muslim, Rajas, kings, both. Now, from the rising classes come up three type of organizations. Now, this I am telling as a part. What are the three types of organization? First organization, there is a representative person who is from ideology of working class, who talks of socialism, and who talks of also India. And this is in the form of Sardar Bhagat Singh. Left ideology, the name of his organization is Hindustan Socialist Republican Association. The second group of people which come up, they launch for social equality. They launch for justice, and this gets represented in a succession to Jyotirao Phule. It gets represented in the name of Dr. Bhimrao Babasaheb Ambedkar. And he formed a lot of democratic organization, the final culmination of which was in the form of Republican Party of India. The third group of people, a vast mass of industrialists, new educated classes, and the national movement comes up. And in this national movement is led by a party I am not going to give a political speech. I am trying to understand it ideologically. And this national movement has people like Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, Annie Besant, Sardar Baldev Singh, and Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Please note the name of the organization here, Indian National Congress. So please note the names of these rising group of people, their organizations. Rising group of people, I told you, businessmen, industrialists, educated people, working classes. And what are the organizations? Hindustan Socialist Republican Association, Republican Party of India, and Indian National Congress, which led the freedom movement. Now, the declining classes, the kings, the feudal lords, they feel threatened by the changes. And when they feel threatened by the changes, in order to preserve their interest, they form certain organizations. What are these organizations? Very simply speaking, on this declining side, initially there were kings and landlords who formed these organizations. Later on, certain educated group of people, upper caste people, also joined them, and these three organizations, I'll tell you. Of course, the first one, they are in that category, comes in the form of Muhammad Ali Jinnah. I hope you know the name of his party, Muslim League. Okay, now then second comes So one side we are seeing Muhammad Ali Jinnah. Then in Maharashtra, one person is very popular, whom we refer to as Veer. Popular, he is called Veer, and I hope some of you name his name is Veer Savarkar, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. I must say, he was not a Veer. He was actually a coward fellow who was went against the British rule. Then he apologized from them. He wrote apology letter, one after the other. Sir, pardon me. I am your most loyal servant, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. And he comes in and joins the organization called Hindu Mahasabha. Now the this cat is out of the bag. What is the first organization from the landlords? Muslim League. What is the second one? Hindu Mahasabha. Hindu Mahasabha talked of Hindu nationalism. It talked of Hindutva. And based on this comes up an organization called, this I will like to leave to the imagination of my audience. So on the agenda of Hindu nation, on the agenda of Hindutva, comes up another organization which is the most menacing organization of today. It is not just political, it is supra-political. It controls the politics from above the ground. And just to guess, in case you can guess their name, earlier they were wearing khaki shorts. Now they are going to wear brown pants. Everybody gets promoted, they have also got promoted. I hope you can guess the point. What is the name? Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. And what nation they want? They want secular democratic nation? No, they want Hindu nation. So please note here, Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, and for Hindu nation, RSS. And here please note the names of the rising classes. Rising classes, Bhagat Singh, Ambedkar, Gandhi. Gandhi as a representative, I may not agree to him fully. But here, the names themselves are secular. The names themselves are democratic. They are not talking of Hindu versus Muslim. They are talking of India as a nation. I agree, Bhagat Singh and Gandhi, lot of differences. I agree, Ambedkar and Gandhi, lot of differences. But there is something we learn in the school that is called lowest common denominator. I have forgotten my mathematics, but still I remember this, LCM. So what is the LCM between Bhagat Singh, Gandhi and Ambedkar? The LCM between Bhagat Singh, Gandhi and Ambedkar gets manifested in five forms. Number one, all of them agree on Indian nationalism. Am I right? They all say Indian nationalism, number one. Number two, they are all talking of secularism. They are all talking of democracy. They are all based on the values of liberty, equality, fraternity. So this is the LCM of Bhagat Singh, Gandhi, Ambedkar. And the other side, there is a Jinnah, there is Savarkar, and there is this Golwalkar, etc., etc., etc. Now what is their lowest common denominator? their lowest common denominator is, according to my understanding, birth-based hierarchy of caste and gender. The essential feature of democratic hierarchies are that they are fluid, they are changeable, and there is a place for negotiation, there is a place for liberal values, there is a place for progressive values. So what is common between Christian fundamentalism in America, Taliban, Islamic fundamentalism, and Hindu communalism? The basic difference is that, basic common factor is that they all believe in the feudal values of kingdoms. They all believe in that we are unequal people. I'll come to this particular point. So I am not here to criticize one particular organization. My anguish is against all that politics which is done under the cover of religion. It may be Christian right in America, it may be Ayatollah Khomeini's Islamic fundamentalism, it may be Taliban's fundamentalism, or it may be RSS communalism of Hindu nation. What is common between that? They want to look at the past. What is common here? They want to look at the future. The rising groups are trying to adjust themselves, trying to articulate the values of industrial democratic society. And what are these people doing? Those who are looking at the past, they present, okay, we had a glorious past, we are a Hindu, we are a Muslim, and we are a nation. This is totally a bogus concept. Why? Because number one, in the past, there was no concept of nation. And when it comes to Hindu nationalism, believe me, you, I want to clarify it here, the very word Hindu comes into being intermittently and becomes stronger actually in 19th century. Before 19th century, the different religious tendencies which were here, they were not talking themselves are Hindu, etc. They were saying, we are Vaishnav, we are Shaiv, we are this, we are Kashyaps. So those Gotra identities, caste identities were primary. From 19th century, the Hindu identity started becoming powerful. Okay, now second difference. The rising nationalist, they believe that India is a nation in the making. And what do declining people say? Declining people, Muslim League, for example. Muslim League will say, though these people are saying, India is a nation in the making. Muslim League said, we are a Muslim nation. We are a Muslim nation since the time Muhammad bin Qasim came to Sindh, attacked Sindh and ruled there. So please note, Muslim League is deriving its identity not from contemporary values. It is deriving its identity from a kingdom of 8th century. Now what are the values of kingdom? I have explained to you. Now to beat them hollow in this game, Hindu Mahasabha and RSS say, okay, you are a Muslim nation from last 1100 years. You are a Muslim nation from 8th century. But we, the Hindus, are a Hindu nation from times immemorial. In Hindi it is called Anadikal. I get confused here. What is Anadikal? Then of course I have a bit exposure to science like many of you. You also must have read that Darwin's theory of evolution, Anadikal. Now our earlier ancestors were living on the trees, no problem. They want to bring which values, I don't know. From those ancestors who were living in the tree, or those ancestors who were rearing cattle, or those ancestors who were doing agriculture, what is their anadikal, I don't know. But of course I have no problem, especially with our ancestors who were living in the trees. What is the problem? So nice, they were jumping from one tree to the another, eating fresh fruits, no pollution, and they did not have a tension of wearing clothes. They also did not have the tension of hearing to the boring lectures. So I have no problem with that particular point of time. Okay. So this Anadikal claim by Hindu Mahasabha RSS that Hindu nation is a nation from Anadikal is a total bogus concept. Nation comes into being with citizenship. To restrict nationhood to a particular type of agriculture or rearing cattle is totally wrong. Anyway, now what is the second point? These people who said that we are a nation in the making, they contributed to the nation making. Bhagat Singh sacrifices his life for the freedom of the country.
Ambedkar struggles all his life to give a structure to the democratic values, to social justice, and to the rights of the Dalits and weaker sections of society. And what does National Movement do? National Movement brings in, unites all the people into the Indian identity. Now, all these people have three different roles. Bhagat Singh has different role, Ambedkar has different role, and National Movement is an overarching movement which unites all of them. And it is through this that Indian nations come into being. So please see, the two concepts of nationalism are totally opposed to each other. It is not a play of words. When your Prime Minister says that I am a Hindu nationalist, he is giving a clear hint that he is working for RSS. He is working for Hindu nationalism. And Hindu nationalism, I'll try to define, it picks up the Brahminical values coming from the time of Vedas, coming from the manifested in Manusmriti, and going up into the form of Gita. All these they pick up in a very, very clever and shrewd manner. So conceptually what happens? Now, second point I wanted to make, people from this side, they contributed to the nation building. Indian nation and Indian Bharat is constituted by everybody, by all of us. Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Isai, Parsi, Jain, Buddha, Yahudi, people of all religions, people of all areas, people of all ethnicities, men and women both, they constitute Indian nation. And who constitutes Muslim nation? Exclusively Muslim Ali. Who constitute Hindu nation? Those people who are holding on to Brahminical values. Here, let me clarify one word before I take up the progenitor of Hindu nationalism, which is the organization called RSS. Before that, let me explain one word, Hindu, Hindutva. There are four words. Number one, Hindu. Number two, Hindu religion. Number three, Hindutva. And number four, Hindu nation. Hindu word comes from 8th century into prominence, and initially it's a word for geographical category. The land spread from Indus River to the sea. This they called as Hindu. And this word Hindu was coined not by anybody in India. It was coined by those people coming from the Western Asia. Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, in their language, the word sir is used less often. In place of that, they use the word her. So what will Sindhu become? Sindhu will become Hindu. So Hindu is geographical explanation. After that, people living in this area started being called as Hindus, and their religion started being called as Hinduism. So Savarkar very cleverly puts forward three concepts to construct the word Hindutva. Earlier also Hindutva word was coined, he gives emphasis to that. So in Hindutva word there are three categories. Number one, Aryan race. Number two, this land. And number three, Brahminical culture. So this is what constitutes Hindutva. Anyway, so these people, Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, RSS, they totally kept aloof from the freedom movement. Very surprising. Those people who never contributed to the formation of Indian nation, who never agreed with the concept of Indian nationalism, today they are bloating their chest to 56 inches and claiming that they are the biggest nationalists, while they have nothing to do with Indian nationalism as such. So Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, RSS, they totally kept aloof from the freedom movement. Their policies were closer to the British policies. They articulated that we should not do anything which goes against the British interest. And let me tell you, the word patriotism is also becoming very popular. In India, the first time the word patriotism was used by declining sections, by Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, their progenitors used the word loyalty. They said, we pledge our loyalty to British. Don't be confused. They did not pledge their loyalty to this country. They did not pledge their loyalty to this land. Their loyalty was to British. And that's why sometimes I see, how come their policies are so much parallel to the ideology, ruling ideology, many times of America, many times of Britain. This is a very amazement to me, but you can try to build up. Okay? So no participation in freedom movement, total criticism of the national movement. They criticize the national movement saying, this national movement is just anti-British. We have to build either a Muslim nationalism or a Hindu nationalism. So this was another point. Okay? In summary, Muslim League, I will not go into detail. After independence, Muslim League, majority communal elements migrated to Pakistan. So what is left behind in Kerala is a practically different type of Muslim League. Please don't get confused about that. I will not go into details of that. Now what happens to Hindu Mahasabha? Hindu Mahasabha gradually deteriorates, and what comes is RSS. Now just a brief about RSS. Why was RSS formed when Hindu Mahasabha was there? Hindu Mahasabha, a party of Hindu nationalists, was there. Still around 1920, certain developments took place. What were these developments? One development was that Ambedkar, under his ideology, a anti-Brahmin, anti-landlord movement was launched in Vidarbha area, Nagpur, central India. Because of that, upper caste, landlord, they got disturbed. Second factor was Mahatma Gandhi, for the first time, invited all the people to become part of the freedom movement. That's where elite people also got disturbed. So, disturbed by the movement of rights for Dalits, disturbed by the national movement, Indian national movement, and thirdly, inspired by the movement ideology of Hitler. Second was national movement, and third, they took inspiration from Hitler, in which Golwalkar of RSS writes that Germany is showing how the nations are formed. Germany, by its treatment of Jews and other minorities, is showing that a nation can be built only by this particular method. So this is what they go. Now, right from their formation, RSS decided that we will have a dictatorship within our organization. So they appointed what is called Sar Sangh Chalak. And their ideology, very simple. That's where, they score very simple ideology. What do you say? Ancient times, Hindu period. All Hindus, excellent. No problem. No caste issue, no gender issue. Everybody very good. How did the problem come? According to them, problem came because Muslims came. Problem came because Christians came. And they tried to convert the people. Now, I must say here, the major conversions did not take place because of the coercion. Major conversion took place, as Swami Vivekananda points out, major conversions took place to escape the tyranny of caste system. This is what Swami Vivekananda, in his collected works, volume 8, page 330, tells us. But still, they tried to construct their ideology around medieval kings. How they proved that Muslim kings were very bad? They gave the example of Aurangzeb, that Aurangzeb killed X and Y because they refused conversion to Islam. I must tell you that the battle between Aurangzeb and some of the Hindu kings was not because of religion. The battle between kings was for power. And same Aurangzeb which got some kings killed, like somebody from Maharashtra, somebody from Punjab, same Aurangzeb had an administration in which 34% of officers were Hindus. One of the big officers of Aurangzeb was Raja Jai Singh, who used to come to Maharashtra to have negotiation with our King Shivaji. So, but they constructed around that. Then they said, oh, look, this Akbar, Man Singh, this is a Hindu-Muslim battle. And how cruel the Muslims are. Let me tell you that kings had battles, Hindu kings, Muslim kings, they used to fight amongst themselves and they used to fight against others also. There are many battles where a Hindu king is fighting Hindu. There are many battles where a Muslim king is battling a Muslim. One example from North India, if you can stomach it, he will explain to you that the founder of Mughal dynasty, Babur, came here on the invitation of Rana Sangha. Rana Sangha was having a battle with Ibrahim Lodi. Rana Sangha wanted Babur to ally with him. So please just see the equation. Rana Sangha at the center, fighting with Ibrahim Lodi, getting Akbar, getting Babur on his side. So there is nothing religious about his. Then about, you must be knowing much about Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan, how Tipu Sultan himself had so many Hindu officers. The major of that Hindu officer was a Pandit Brahman called Purnaya. Our Shivaji had a big officer in the name of Maulana Haider Ali. So this history was distorted by British, what historians call as communal historiography. This communal historiography, where the past is seen through the prism of king's religion, this was picked by the RSS, Hindu Mahasabha on one side and Muslim League on the other. This is actually what started generating hatred in people's minds. This was what was the foundation of training the young volunteers in the RSS shakhas. Now anyway, interestingly, I want to just point out two things. One is, how do I explain that ideology of RSS is totally opposed to the values of Indian constitution? In symbolic small way, I'll take two examples. One example from the rising classes, one from the declining classes. The rising classes example is that of Dr. Ambedkar. Declining classes example is that of one person called K. Sudarshan. I don't know how, you must have heard, he was once the Sarva Sangha Chalak of RSS in year 2000. Okay. Now, Ambedkar in his life launched many movements. One of the movement was to have access to the public drinking water. Second was to have access to the temple, Kalaram temple. With experience of both these, Dr. Ambedkar went on to get a book burnt, and the name of the book was Manusmriti. While getting the Manusmriti burnt, Dr. Ambedkar says, Manusmriti gives the provisions, the clauses of slavery. Manusmriti gives the provisions of slavery for Shudras, Dalits and women. I oppose that. That's why I support the burning of this book. Same Dr. Ambedkar went on to become the chief architect of drafting committee of Indian Constitution. So here is my Ambedkar, burning Manusmriti, drafting Indian Constitution. What does Indian Constitution give us? It gives us the value of liberty, equality, fraternity. Now, on the other side, I was talking about K. Sudarshan, and there are certain resolutions by Vishwa Hindu Parishad and others. What do they say? They say that Indian constitution is a Western constitution. It is a foreign constitution. It should be thrown away. Before that, I want to ask myself a question. Indian constitution is Western constitution or modern constitution? I will say it's a modern constitution. But how does RSS see it? RSVHB sees? How does Sangha Parivar see it? They see it as a Western constitution. So they said, Sudarshan said that throw away Indian constitution and bring a constitution based on the Hindu holy books. What is a Hindu holy book which gives the laws, provisions? That is Manusmriti. So here is Dr. Ambedkar burning Manusmriti, making Indian constitution. Here is the Hindutva RSS ideology talking of throwing away Indian constitution and bringing up a constitution based on Manusmriti. Just to elaborate the point, RSS has been talking about these things. One of the things get reflected in its terminology also. There are two hierarchies which are central to politics in the name of religion. Just remember this. What are these two hierarchies? One is that of caste, second is that of gender. And this gender hierarchy I'll present first, and there I generally give a grammar test. What is the grammar test? What is the full form of RSS? Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. Please note, Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. It's a masculine gender or feminine gender? Masculine gender. Okay. Now, can women be the part of RSS? Fortunately not. Fortunately not. So what is the organization which is subordinate to RSS, which is meant for women? That organization is Rashtra Sevika Samiti. Please introspect. What is the name of the male organization? Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. What is the name of organization for women? Rashtra Sevika Samiti. So what is missing in that? one word is missing, and that word is Swayam. Swayam is a Sanskritized word. I hope you all understand. Swayam means my being. According to every male-dominated patriarchal ideology, repeat, according to every male-dominated patriarchal ideology, the Swayam, the being of women, is supposed to be in the pocket of man. That's why I humorously say, that's why men's shirts have pockets. I don't know whether that is right or wrong, or somebody can do a research, particular research on that. And the second point comes in the form of caste. About caste, there are a lot of complex things. I will not go into that. And basically, about caste, I want to tell you that all through, all the RSS ideologues have been upholding Manusmriti and those texts which are having caste hierarchy. Please don't misunderstand me. One book which many people revere unknowingly, the name of that book is Gita. And Sushma Swaraj even said that Gita should become our national book. What is our national book? Indian Constitution. What do they want our national book to be? Gita. That's why our Prime Minister, with all his big chest, etc., when he goes abroad, he presents to other dignitaries a copy of Gita. I will not go into details of what Gita says. I'll just give a summary of Gita in the words of Bhim Rao Ambedkar. Ambedkar says in one of his essays that Gita is Manusmriti in nutshell. Manusmriti in nutshell. And that's why is Krishna made to fight? Because he's a Kshatriya. He's a Kshatriya. It is a duty of Kshatriya to fight. So basically, it's a strong endorsement of the caste system. And it is not up to that. Gita, trying to make it a national book, along with that, they are also seeing, they have appointed those people in the places of power which believe in the caste system. Only one example I'll give. I'll leave it open for question answer after 5 minutes. And that example is that of another Sudarshan, one we talked of, K. Sudarshan, RSS chief. Now I'm talking of Y. Sudarshan. Y. Sudarshan. Who's he? He has been appointed the chief of Indian Council of Historical Research. I'm not going to talk of his academic competence. That we'll talk some other time. I'll just tell you that after becoming the ICHR chief, this professor told us that there is nothing wrong with the caste system. Caste system gave stability to Indian society. So what follows? What follows, you can guess. So on the one side caste, another side gender. And thirdly, lastly today, what is the danger today? You must have seen from last 3 years, 2.5 years, all things which are democratic are being abolished. Cabinet system is being replaced by rule of one system, one person. And you know the name of that person, I will not repeat that. Now, he can sometimes do demonetization, sometimes he can keep visiting abroad as if there is no foreign minister. He is expert of everything, right from cleanliness to external affairs, everything is under his control, even economy is under his control. So this type of pattern is that of an authoritarian state. Number two, what is happening to our universities? What are universities meant for? Universities are meant for development of knowledge. And there has to be autonomy in these universities. So whenever there is autonomy, they have tried to replace that autonomy by authoritarian structure. I respect JNU's culture very strongly, but that culture is being demolished. I respect Hyderabad Central University, that is being demolished. Film and Television Institute of India, the type of chairman they have appointed, now competence is not important. Allegiance, worship of khaki short ideology is important for them. That's why these type of appointments are going on. Then every time intolerance, Amir Khan makes a beautiful film. He says, my wife is worried, violence is going on. So immediately the fatwa comes, oh, Amir Khan should go to Pakistan. I don't know how many people can go to Pakistan, 71% of Indians and more than 70% of Indians. So this atmosphere of intolerance, of course, currently demonetization is a very important issue. I will not talk about that. That is a topic by itself. But overall, there is a sense of repression from the top. And what is this going on? From the top, earlier, now there is a freedom for the organizations in bottom. RSS is not alone. RSS has hundreds of subordinate organizations, Vishwa Hindu Parishad, Bajrang Dal, Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram, Bharatiya Janata Party, etc., etc. So they were active earlier also. Now what has happened? Because of this government coming to power, they get all the facilities from the top. Now they are fearless. They can do whatever they want and wherever they want. That is the particular type of thing. So in this atmosphere, friends, what do we do? I must urge upon you that India's democracy is a hard-earned democracy. 100 years of freedom movement, hundreds of martyrs, lakhs and lakhs of people went to jail. And those people who kept aloof from that, today they are dictating that we should become a Hindu nation. I have no problems with Hinduism. I have no problems with Islam. I have problems with use of Hinduism for political goals. And this is the last point I'll make. Please note, I said two points here, two names here. One was Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. Tell me, friends, was he a Muslim or not? He was a Muslim. Did he support Muslim League? No. Did he support Pakistan? No. And if I take an imaginary interview with Maulana Saab, I ask him, Maulana Saab, you are a Muslim. Why don't you join Muslim League? Why don't you call for Pakistan? So Maulana Saab will reply to me, gentlemen, young man, my Islam teaches me to unite humanity. While Muslim League is talking of division. If I talk to Gandhi, Mohandas Gandhi, you are a Hindu. Why you are not joining RSS? Why you are not joining Hindu Mahasabha? He will tell me, my Hinduism teaches me Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. And Hindu Mahasabha RSS, they are spreading venom, hatred against the people of my own country. And this hatred is the basis of violence. Please note, I am glad Kerala is comparatively free from this infection, but this infection is picking up. Let me warn you. And this infection is a very dangerous infection. I have nothing to do with the identity of religion. These people, Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, even in South, in Sri Lanka, Myanmar, they are using Buddhism as a cover for politics. So please differentiate between religions, moral values, and religions used in politics. These people don't take up the issues of human rights. These people don't take up the issues of bread, butter, shelter, employment, education, and health. What they take up? They take up the issue of identity. Ram temple. Gau hamari mata hai, Hindi word. Cow is our mother. Of course, I don't know, you people are very serious. Whenever I say cow is our mother, some people from the audience shout back, saying, asking, if cow is your mother, who's your father? Many times I don't have an answer. Anyway, so these issues are important to us. People dying of hunger, farmer suicide, and ill effects because of demonetization is not their concern. Their concern, lately I recognize, is one of the strengthening of the corporate sector. You do denotification, you operate through that Paytm, etc., etc., and automatically when you spend 100 rupees, 1 rupee is deducted roughly as a commission, and that goes to fatten up our already rich corporate sector. So friends, please don't think I am against any religion, but I am strongly against use of religion for political goals. I want to assert as a citizen that we should have values of liberty, equality, fraternity. We should look into the future. We should look into the times ahead. We should not try to just glorify the past era and try to bring in values which relate to the past. So this is my appeal to you. These powers are very clever. They incite emotions. Emotions lead to violence. Violence leads to polarization. Polarization leads to a particular type of politics. So it is time for us, friends, to be aware of the dangers what this politics can bring in, because our democracy is a hard-earned democracy. To preserve it is the duty of each and every citizen who wants to enjoy citizenship in the times to come. Thank you very much.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, for thank
you so much. Keep mic at a distance. Keep mic at a distance. I can hear. Yeah. Yeah. Be brief in your question.
I want to ask you whether a book or a particular thing for an act should be looked for its interpretability or for one person's right to communicate by his.
Yeah.
This is a point which I would like to request a little bit better.
See, Ambedkar's reason for burning Smriti was nothing personal. It was social. It was related to social justice. What is the personal about the value? Liberty is not a personal value. It's a social value. It's a national value. It's a human value. So that way, what Ambedkar was doing was nothing personal about it. He himself says that I am converting to Buddhism. If I want, I can continue with my privileges. But I want that the whole society should have democratic values and we should throw away the yoke of Brahminical values, which are the core of Hindu religion. That's what he was trying to say. Yeah. If I can understand another question. Communist parties and freedom movement. See, actually, unfortunately, communist parties here, they are very much rooted in the workers' movement. They are very much rooted in the issues of the people. But earlier, I think, they used to carry their umbrella when it was raining in Moscow. That was a problem. So they were a part of the freedom movement. Then Russia joined in. And when Russia came in, they also withdrew and they allied with the British. So communists are very complex characters. But by and large, I say, if there are two extremes, on one side there is a Hindu right, on the other side there is a communist. Communists are basically committed to the issues of people. That's why I think we should try to understand a bit of their limitations also. Because communist ideology came from abroad. Like Ambedkar came up organically from here. Communist ideology, sympathetic to workers, but it was mechanistically tried in India. Had they creatively tried here, they would have allied with Ambedkar, they would have taken up the issues of Dalits. Even now they should take up the issues of Dalits more than anybody else. But because they read Karl Marx at night and do politics in the day, that's why they are bound to commit mistakes one after the other. But still, I say, They are good people in the sense they are on the left side of the spectrum, and left is always for social change.
Sir, so far as I understand, 80% of people of Kerala work for Muslim. When 80% of Muslims work for Muslim in Kerala, only 5% afford staying for granted. But when 80% of Hindus in Gujarat work for
Yeah. See, one is that voting for BJP is not a crime. But I'll tell you, a study has come out from Yale University. I hope you know Yale University, America. How it became famous? Because one of our ministers, who was our MHRD minister, what is her name? Smriti Irani. She had got a degree from there, that's what she claimed. Since that university has become very famous. What did Yale University result tell us? It tells us that wherever communal violence takes place, the BJP becomes stronger. So we cannot compare Muslims voting for Muslim League and Hindus voting for BJP. Those Hindus where communal violence is orchestrated, they get polarized and they vote for BJP. While the Muslim League of Kerala, I am not defending here, but it has a different character. It is a sort of a defensive communalism. BJP is an aggressive communalism. So these are two separate things. Aggressive communalism, defensive communalism. Both communalisms are bad. I don't support communalism. I gave the example of Gandhi. Gandhi was a Hindu, but he was not believing in Hindutva. I gave the example of Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. He was not supporting Muslim League. So what happens in democracy after secularization? Religion becomes a personal value. I may be atheist, but I believe that some people will like to follow the religion. I have no problem. But when politics is done in the name of religion, for Ram temple, for beef, for other things even related to Islam or Christianity, that is a problem. So bringing religion to political arena is a problem, and following religion personally is a different thing. These, I don't think we should mix up two things. Yeah. See, we can't compare agricultural society or a society of hunters and gatherers with today's society. Moral norms have kept developing. Before religions, like humanism first expressed in the religions, right? But I don't want to stop there. Humanism today gets expressed maximally in United Nations Charter of Human Rights. But we should know the reality, okay? So earlier, the norms which are there in the hunter society, agriculture society, from there morality starts coming up in the form of Buddhism, Christianity, in the form of Islam, Sikhism. So that moral concept is again taken up by the powers. Religion is taken up by the powers, moral values remain behind, and they use clergy for imposing political values. So that's what I'm trying to distinguish. So here religion has two components. One is morality, second is identity. Morality has no issues, but identity, Ram temple, beef issue, that creates a problem, and that's how that becomes the basis of politics for certain people, which I think is retrograde. And actually, I say, tell me, Indian constitution has morality or not? It has immense morality. United Nations Charter of Human Rights has morality or not? It has immense morality. So religion brought in certain morality, but that morality is superseded by the concept of human rights. So today, my religion is human rights. What do you say about that, right? But I say, Jesus Christ did contribute to morality, Buddha did contribute to morality, Guru Nanak did contribute to morality, but that's not the alpha and omega. That's not the last word. Human morality should keep evolving till your pain becomes my pain. My pain becomes your pain. That is the highest form of morality which human society should aspire for. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Pleasure for me talking to you. Thanks.